So when I was a PhD student, I did my PhD at Imperial College with Peter Knight, who works in quantum optics. And I became interested in Barry's face,
uh-huh.
you know, from Michael Barry. So how he talks about, well, the typical example is that you have a spin 1/2 particle in a magnetic field. And then if you change the magnetic field in a cyclic way, then you say, okay, let's say you have the spin 1/2 particle in the up direction, and then you change very slowly adiabatically the magnetic field, the quantum state will follow, and then you make, let's say, a trajectory like a circle, and then you come back. Well, you're still in the same state. But Michael Barry showed that the state can pick up a phase, because states in quantum mechanics are indistinguishable up to a phase, and this is called the geometric phase or the Barry phase. So when I was a PhD student, this was kind of, although Michael had sort of done the physics of these phases and so on earlier on, they kind of were going through a revival because of some ideas that, because they're sort of resilient to noises at the end, what really matters is sort of the area enclosed by the state, and not like maybe little changes in the laser or fluctuations like this, they get sort of averaged out. So okay. They seem to be resilient, and people thought, oh, maybe we can use them for quantum computing. So that was kind of the motivation. And so as a PhD student, I got interested in that. And I started to, let's say, propose experiments on how to measure certain effects. But one thing that I found was this example of the Barry phase was usually discussed with classical fields. So you have the spin particle is a quantum system, but the electromagnetic field driving it is a classical field. So then I thought, oh, wouldn't it be nice to put a quantum field instead of a classical field and see what happens with these Barry phases? So I studied that, and in particular, a big difference that you have with a quantum field as compared to a classical field is that the quantum field has this sort of vacuum energy. So if the field was classical and you say you have no field, well, the system would not get a geometric phase, would not do anything. But what I saw is how the vacuum state of the field could be driving the states to get geometric phases. So this was called vacuum-induced geometric phase. So I wrote that on my PhD. I was kind of very pleased with it. Uh-huh. Michael Barry was my examiner, so that was also very nice.
Cool.
He was tough and strict, but it went very well. So it was really nice to meet him. And well, and then after that, somebody wrote a paper saying that that effect did not exist. And there was a back and forth, not with me, because I had moved on into relativistic quantum information. And people were saying, like, Yvette, you need to go back and defend your work because these authors, you know, wrote that this effect does not exist. But I felt I was just so invested in the new work I was doing. And I thought, no. I mean, I did my contribution there and I'm not gonna go back. But it gave me quite a few citations because there was a community fighting over it. And then finally, in ATH, in the group of Andrea Warloff, he measured it. And it was very funny. I went there to a conference on time. I wasn't expecting at all, you know, to hear about this. I was at the conference and since somebody came and said, oh, are you Yvette Fuentes? And I was like, yes. Oh, I need to talk to you. I was like, oh, that's very funny. And he said, oh, I'm a postdoc working on vacuum-induced Barry phase. I'll say, oh, that's very nice. He said, just we very recently verified your result and the effect is there and we will very soon publish it. And I was like, oh, wow, that was super exciting.
Congrats.
Yeah, so that's a nice example of you know, some predictions and that then get tested is very, very satisfying as a theoretician.
Tell me another example of some things you've predicted that have gotten tested.
Okay. So, well, I started to work in the interface of quantum mechanics and relativity using quantum field theory in curved space-time. So that's what is now known as relativistic quantum information. And one of the things that we noticed was that you can implement quantum gates by sort of relativistic motion. So we were looking at things like the dynamical Casimir effect. So that is, you have two mirrors and a quantum field. And then if you move the boundary conditions, you excite particles out of the quantum vacuum. So it's called the dynamical Casimir effect. Then, like more recently, I can talk about that later, but we sort of were able to describe this situation in curved space, which was something that was not possible before. And I was very keen in doing that also because of a number of applications that you can find to that. But well, back in the day when I started to work on relativistic quantum information, we noticed that by moving sort of the cavity in a certain way, you would be able to implement quantum gates, in particular a cluster state. So a cluster state is known as a universal resource for quantum computing. So there are states that are like highly entangled and you can use them to do quantum computing with them. And we wrote a paper, a theoretical paper showing how you could implement a cluster state changing sort of the cavity in space or something like this. But you can just do it by modulating the boundary conditions. So then Chris Wilson in the University of Waterloo became interested in our work. And he had superconducting circuits. So you have also like, let's say like a cavity, and then you have boundary conditions. Like instead of mirrors, the boundary conditions are fields.
Okay.
And then you can change sort of the conditions of the boundary conditions and move them by changing fields that go through a squid. This is
maybe a squid.
Squid is just some sort of. Maybe I shouldn't go into so much.
What does it stand for?
But superconducting.
I see. Okay.
I'm not remembering right now.
Yeah. Whatever. We'll place a link on screen.
Yeah. Just. But the point is that you change a current that goes through this electronic device, and what it does is that it produces these fields that you can modulate. Chris Wilson did with Pearl Delsing in the University of Chalmers a really beautiful experiment in which by doing that, they demonstrated the dynamical Casimir effect. So this was like a big thing because the effect was is very small. So if you think about mirrors that move, let's say, close to the speed of light or something like this, but real mirrors,
okay,
right? You would produce something like 2 photons in the lifetime of the sun or something,
okay,
like this. So it's like a super small effect from quantum field theory. And obviously, because of these numbers, people were not very hopeful that the dynamical Casimir effect could be demonstrated in the experiment. However, the group of Pearl Delsing had this wonderful idea of using the superconducting circuits, because in that case, using instead of mirrors, using fields as a boundary condition, you can modulate them very fast to 1/3 of the speed of light. And, these are starts to be the scales that you can show that you are exciting particles out of the quantum vacuum. And yeah, so they wrote a really beautiful paper showing this. Gosh, I forgot the year, but this was already maybe 2011 comes to my mind, but it might have been earlier than that.
Sure, we'll place it on screen.
Yes. So then this was exactly sort of the sort of situation that we were considering, only that it was going beyond just showing that you create particles, but that you would be able to create this resource for quantum computing, cluster states, or other quantum gates. And then Chris took like the simplest case for a quantum gate in this system and showed in his lab. Chris Wilson was working with parallel dowsing in chambers, but then at the time he finished his work there and moved on a permanent position to the University of Waterloo, where he set up his lab. And he did this experiment and verified our predictions. And that I'm in the paper with them. So that was also kind of very exciting for me.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.